me sit with you.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to be with you guys this morning. And we're really glad to have Wayne and Lynette Hardy, who came all the way from Oklahoma City area up here. So
Tulsa
area. So, yeah, so glad to have you guys here. Always good to just be able to worship with everybody. Such a beautiful time of year before the bugs get out and the weather's cool and beautiful, and it's not blowing 100 miles an hour anyways. So a lot to be thankful for right now. And as always, we want to gather around our mission statement, the reason that we are planting this new church here, which is that by grace we are rooted in the gospel, committed to growing together, and sent to love Lakin and the nations. If you would please stand and join Chad in the call to worship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So today's text, today's call to worship, is from Revelation 15:3-4. Great and
marvelous are your deeds, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are your ways, King of the nations. Who will not fear you, Lord, and bring glory to your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship before you, for your righteous acts have been revealed.
Thank you.
One of our scripture readings is from 2 Chronicles 6. Then Solomon said, "The Lord has said that he would dwell in a dark cloud. I've built a magnificent temple for you, a place for you to dwell forever. But will God indeed dwell with man on earth? Behold, heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you. How much less this house that I have built? Yet have regard to the prayer of your servant and to his plea, O Lord my God, listening to the cry and to the prayer that your servant prays before you, that your eyes may be opened day and night toward this house, the place where you promised to set your name, that you may listen to the prayer that your servant offers to this place, and listen to the pleas of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray toward this place." And, okay, I lost it, didn't I? As soon as Solomon finished his prayer, the fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices. And the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And the priests could not enter the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord filled the Lord's house. When all the people of Israel saw the fire come down and the glory of the Lord on the temple, they bowed down with their faces to the ground on the pavement and worshiped and gave thanks to the Lord, saying, "For he is good, and his steadfast love endures forever." Then the king and all the people offered sacrifice before the Lord. Let's take a few moments and silently confess our sin before the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, we know that we have said things, thought things, and done things that are not pleasing to you. And so we ask now that you would hear the silent confessions of our hearts. Now hear the assurance of pardon. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love to those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove his transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion on his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, does not boast, is not proud, It does not dishonor others, it's not self-seeking, it's not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. This is a very well-known passage. I've done a lot of weddings in my ministry, and this used to be the most requested passage for a wedding. And we use the word love in many different ways. Like if someone says something that I like, I say, I love that. Or I see a car that's really sweet, I say, I love that. But that word love that I toss around pretty lightly is very different than the Bible's view of love. The Bible's view of love really consists of our relationship with the Lord and His unconditional love for us, and also how we should love other people. So what I'd like to cover today, and it's not going to be a long, so it sounds like it's going to be a really long sermon, but it's not. I'd like to cover love in marriage, how we love people at work, how we love ourselves, and how we love God. Well, let's go over that. Let's first talk about love in marriage. What does that mean? If you listen to actresses and actors today, they will tell you, at last, I found my soulmate. And if they kind of define what that is, they'll say something like, well, you know, with him or her, we really click. And my question is, what do you do when the clicking stops? Because clicking does stop, right, in marriage, if we're honest. So, how do we love in marriage? Tim and Kathy Keller have written a wonderful book called The Meaning of Marriage. And in this book, they basically say these sorts of things, that when we, before we get married and we're dating, we tend to overlook all of those attributes that will at one time might annoy us after we're married. We live in an ideal sort of existence before we get married. And after you get married, two things start to happen. The first thing is the person is not the person you dream that person to be. That's one thing. They do certain things to annoy you, as I've said. I've heard young women tell me after they're married, I did not know that he would leave his clothes on the floor. This drives me crazy. One time I did marriage counseling for a guy who'd been married for a while, and he was just really upset. He was like compulsive about making everything neat. He was one of those kind of guys. And so he was angry at his wife because her perfume bottles were rolled over the bathroom counter and it just drove him crazy. And I looked at him and said, you don't have a problem, fella. It's just something you got to get used to. The second thing you see early on in marriage is how the one you love starts to point out your imperfections. You thought you were a pretty good guy or a pretty good woman before you got married, but suddenly a light starts to shine on the things that you thought were okay but probably were not. So what's interesting to me is how God brings together two very different people together. I just counseled a young couple, just finished my fourth session with them in premarital counseling, and I said, you are really opposite. And I said, that's good, because the Lord does that. And in Genesis, God says the two will become one flesh, right? And that's repeated in Ephesians 5. The two will become one flesh. But what does that really mean? Among other things, it means how God has brought two very different people together to make those two people better than they used to be. And it's amazing how that works. So I'll tell young couples, now, remember what brought you together. You love this guy because he's outgoing, he really likes to do things, and you're introverted, you like to kind of stay at home. And remember, he's going to be the guy who wants to get out and do things, and you're going to be the person who wants to stay home, and he needs to stay at home a little bit, and you need to learn to get out a little bit. And so, God has brought two people that are very different, and as you grow together through the years of marriage, it's incredible how the two become one flesh really happens. And you start to become a different person if you're really listening to your husband and wife and you grow together. Now, here's what the Apostle Paul and how he guides us in Philippians 2. This is often read in weddings too. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and one of mind. Now, Paul guides us to remember how Christ comforts us from his love. As Christ lives in our lives and loves us, we in turn should love each other. And what that means is humbling ourselves before the Lord and humbling ourselves enough before the person that we've married that we say, will you forgive me? Please forgive me. And if they say that, then we'll say, yeah, I forgive you. And you know, if you don't do that, marriages really come apart if you're not practicing what the Lord has entered into our lives. Now, something else I counsel young couples in marriage that I would say to all of us that have been married for a while, have a date night once a week so that you keep the romance in your relationship going. Always have something that you look forward to when you're together in marriage. Because if you don't do that, I say you'll probably come to me and you'll want to have a little marriage counseling. I'll refer you to a real counselor and it'll cost you $200 an hour. Now, which would you rather do? Want a date or spend $200 to listen to a counselor? Because he's going to say the same sort of thing for you. Okay. Now, I want to just reemphasize you, when we got married, even though our culture is pushing this, and then I'm saying this too if you have kids that are going to get married one day, you're not marrying a soulmate. You are marrying someone that you love greatly. They're not perfect. You're not perfect. And so we need to work this thing out together through the love of Christ. All right. Now, I want to just jump down to verse 7, where Paul tells us what true love is. First of all, it always protects. Again, when I'm doing marriage counseling, I'll say to the guy, are you protecting your wife? I'll say to the wife, are you protecting your husband? Paul says in Ephesians 5 that wives should submit to your husbands as to the Lord. That's in Ephesians 5. And then also have reverence for your husbands. And then husbands are to honor their wives. I think, guys, we struggle with that a lot. Are we? That's the question. Are we honoring our wives? Do we honor her? Do we let her know she's the best in our relationship? Are we honoring her? That's showing love. Paul goes on to say love always trusts. It means that you grow in trust as you learn to grow together in marriage. All right, now I want to talk about what love means at work. When you're not with your wife, but you're with people. I believe 1 Corinthians is written and sandwiched in between 1 Corinthians 12 and 1 Corinthians 14, which talks about spiritual gifts. And we believe in the church that all of us have been given a spiritual gift. And those gifts are to be used. None of you should feel too shy that you don't have anything to offer the Lord. You have something to offer this church. You have something great that will make this church whole. But in that, how do you relate to people when you're not in church? How do you relate to people again at work? I think we're living in a world, you know this, where it's really easy to throw someone under the bus through social media just like that. Their whole identity can be destroyed just quickly like that. What are we supposed to do in a world like that? I'll give you a personal example of what happened to me. During my college and seminary days, I was blessed, because it paid really well, to work at the post office. And the clerks and the carriers soon learned that I was going to be a pastor one day. And so they came in sarcastically and they'd say, "Morning, Reverend." And so that really kind of irritated me. And then they would try to tell off-color jokes, kind of get me turned red and those sorts of things. And finally I thought, I'm not going to get irritated So I started saying, well, you know, I'm going to pray for you. And if they shared something, I would say, I'm going to pray for you. And then I follow up, how is that prayer being answered? Well, what's going on in your life right now? Do you know what happened? So as I ended my time and was getting ready to start my first church, the whole group of people that I worked with in that shift came to church to hear me preach before I left. And most of them hadn't been in church forever or for a long time. And that's how the Lord worked. And I learned an important lesson where you work. Pray for the people that you work with. Try to build relationships with them, and the Lord will honor it. You know, but the tougher place that I've had to learn to love is the church. What does it mean to love people in the church? I've served three churches in my ministry. St. James Presbyterian Church in Littleton, Colorado, second. First Presbytery, Brainerd, Minnesota. I'm from New Mexico, Farmington, New Mexico. Brainerd, Minnesota was like missionary stuff for me. But we ended up really loving Brainerd, Minnesota. And then I ended up being at Kirk of the Hills Presbytery in Tulsa, Oklahoma for 31 years. So most of my ministry was spent at Kirk of the Hills. By the way, we were one of the first churches to leave the PCUSA. And we had paid $1.79 million back to the denomination to buy our building back that they hadn't given any money for, but I'm not bitter. I forget. I'm going to ask for forgiveness. So, in my first years in Littleton, Colorado, though, there was a pastor that I worked with. I was a youth minister, and he was rebelling against a conservative Baptist background. He had become a Presbyterian, but was rebelling against all that conservative stuff. I had grown up in a liberal Presbyterian church, and I wanted people to learn the Bible, grow in faith, and all those sorts of things. And so I remember going to him and saying, you know, I'd really like to start a Bible study with our high school students. And he said, no, I don't think our kids need a Bible study. So our relationship was always going like this. And so I went to Lynette's dad. By the way, Lynette's father was a pastor in Jetmore, Kansas, Presbyterian pastor. And then the Lord called him to be a Navy chaplain during the Cuban Missile Crisis. And though they moved all around the world after that. And so I went to him, and I wanted him to give me some sympathy and kind of say, you can do it, Wayne. Here's what he said. It's not his fault, Wayne. It's your fault. And you need to go before him once a week, give him a report, and let him know what you're doing. And you need to pray for him. At the end of our time there at St. James in Littleton, Colorado, that guy and I are friends. Because of that action, love is patient, love is kind. Everything Paul talks about can happen if we practice what true love is in the Christian life. Now, in other churches, I was amazed in Brainerd and Kirk of the Hills how unchristlike people could be. I kept thinking, this is a church where people should be behaving much better. But then I started thinking that having the attributes of being patient, kind, and envious, and keeping no record of wrongs is something that you have to learn. It's not something that you are. It's something you have to become. And so I started pouring these words. Our mission statement at Kirk of the Hills that we devised was transformed by Christ. Why? To transform the world. It's very similar to what you're saying. Grace changes the heart, and as we grow in faith, we are different people. And I can tell you, after being in a church for 31 years, Lynette and I have been blessed to see people who live this way, not so good, that are now living for Jesus Christ. Their lives have been totally changed. What a blessing it's been to be at that church that long and see that. So the Lord can work, He can transform, He can change if we practice these principles of Christian love. Now, it would be easy to look at 1 Corinthians 13 as a checklist. It's not a checklist. It's really a transformation of the way we live. As Christians, we live very differently. And we treat each other very differently. Erica was talking last night about this church. And she is correct in saying, if this church is going to flourish, we need to treat each other, he didn't say it quite this way, but we need to treat each other in Christ-like ways so that people see the transformation taking place in our lives here, right? That's how it happens. I messed up my page, I'm sorry. So what can we do in the church? What we can do in church world is we do this. I've seen this happen. Okay, someone offends us in the church. Someone hurts our feelings. And we can make this choice. I am not going to talk to you again. I'll be nice to you because I'm a Christian. I'm not going to talk to you. I will talk about you behind my back, but I'm not going to talk to you. And that's not what Christian love means at all, as you know. We have got to treat each other in ways that love. A seminary professor of mine wrote a book called Forgive and Forget. And he said that we can't forget, but we can forgive. And forgiveness is transformation. How do we forgive? I'm a big believer again in prayer. We start praying for the person that we need to forgive. Lord, give me the strength to forgive this person that I'm really struggling with. Jesus told us, pray for those who persecute us. And as you pray, the person who has wronged you, just as I've given examples, will start to change. You will change for sure if you pray for them and your attitude toward them. It may take years. This is not instantaneous. It takes time for a person to change. But I guarantee you, if you keep praying, you hang in there with that person, that can change miraculously. Do you realize that when Jesus Christ, who we just celebrated Easter and the resurrection, when he was at the Garden of Gethsemane, remember he asked those disciples, I am agonizing, I'm about to die, can you guys stay with me? And three times he comes back while they're doing sleeping. Did Jesus forgive those disciples? He did. And that example should tell us how we should treat other people as we live our lives. When we understand the depth of Christ's love for us, it really changes the way that we should love others. I've talked a lot about loving others, but here's the question. Do you love yourself? We can love other people, but do you love you? Sometimes I struggle, and Lynette will tell you, by self-talk. And I say things to myself. I wouldn't say it to you, but I say it to me. And I start demeaning myself, and Lynette says, stop. And she's right. It's one of those husband and wife things where she's helping me. Stop it. And my question is, do you love yourself? Because you know God loves you. Do you love yourself? I took a doctor of ministry course called Ministers Personal Growth, and was taught by a professor who was dean of the School of Psychology at Fuller Seminary's School of Psychology. And so we're in a class in Ministers Personal Growth. He started every class with a devotional. And so this day he started with these words. We're all pastors. I want you to know Jesus loves you. We're kind of thinking. We teach on that all the time. I know Jesus loves you. Yeah. Then he said, I want you to know Jesus loves you. We're starting to feel a little uncomfortable because we're wondering what he's up to. He's a psychology professor. And then he says, I want you to know Jesus loves you, not because of what you do, he loves you. And we start tearing up. There wasn't a dry eye in place because most of us have given our lives to ministry, but we have forgotten about God's love for us. I hope you haven't forgotten about God's love for you. He loves you. He doesn't love you for what you do. He doesn't love you for what you don't do. He loves you. He loves you. Never forget that. So what's a Christian? A Christian is someone who knows that they're loved by Christ. And because of that depth of that love, then we want to show love to other people. When we realize that God is loving us, not for what we bring, God loves us just because. He loves us. He loves you. I've heard through the years people who say, well, I can't go back to that church anymore because my father died, and so now I'm mad at God. I heard of a guy recently who was mad at God because the person that he wanted to win the election, the national election for president, didn't get it, so he's mad at God for that. Really? What is a Christian? But what makes a Christian? Because I think people who make that statement are not converted. If you are converted to Jesus Christ, you know in the depth of your being that God loves you. You know that no one is immune from suffering in their lives. You know that life is not always easy. And you know that God will be with you no matter what you face in life. That's conversion. And as you grow in faith, you learn that more and more and more. Jonathan Edwards, the great Reformed historian in the United States, in his book, Religious Affection, says that non-Christians are religious. Religious and moral people respect God, but they don't have love for God. Religious and moral people seek God for his benefits, but a Christian is someone who's seen the love and sees that it overwhelms him and saves him, and as a result finds beauty in their hearts, a sense of loveliness of what God did. And you want to obey him simply because you want to please him. That's Christian love. And when you understand the depths of God's love for you, it makes it easier for you to love other people. So what have we learned this morning? Well, first of all, if we're married, we need to be nice to each other. We need to love each other as Christ loves us. It also means, if you're younger, and I would say even for Lynette and me, it doesn't matter your age, you express your love by doing things. I want to tell you something that the professor also got to me. We're sitting there, and he asked this question, do you honor your wife? I'm like, nope. And so when I got back, I honored my wife. And sometimes we're kind of clueless as guys, and we need help and direction to honor our wives and take care of them and let them know that we love them. So, are you honoring your wife? Are you doing what you should do in your marriage? Secondly, can you do loving somebody at work? Are you starting with somebody at work? Pray for them. How about church? Have you left a church because someone has done something to you and you're mad and you're here and all of that sort of stuff? Let that not be this church. Let this church, it's called grace. And that means that we're all saved by grace, we're all very imperfect, and we all need each other. We all have gifts to offer, every one of us, and this church will be healthier if you use those gifts. That's what love is, and that's it. Let's close the prayer. Father in heaven, we are so grateful for your love for us. Help us never forget the depth of your love for us, that you came not because we were perfect. While we were yet sinners, you died for us. It was not at the right time, our time, it was in your time. Thank you, Father, that you work in each of our lives by the Holy Spirit, and may we return the love you give us to our loved ones, that they will see the change taking place in our lives, that we're not the same people, because we're growing in grace and Grace Church. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to now take our tithes and offerings, and I'll read a scripture from Hebrews 13. Keep your lives free from the love of money, and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you.
Thank you.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and always. Amen.
Amen.